Good evening. I'm Linda Lara from the Aspen Institute, and I'd like to welcome you to the first program in our Conversation with Great Leaders series for 2015. For those of you who are joining us here for the first time, I'd also like to welcome you to Roosevelt House, the historic home of Sarah and Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt, and the Public Policy Institute of Hunter College. And Jennifer left? Okay. Well, anyway, I was going to thank Jennifer and her wonderful staff for allowing us to share their beautiful space as Aspen's kind of home away from home in New York City. I'd also like to welcome to the Aspen Institute the Society of Fellow Members who are here tonight. The New York SOF, as we call it, is growing rapidly, and we're in the process of planning some very exciting programs for 2015. You can find out more about the Society of Fellows by picking up one of these brochures at the check-in desk, or we have somebody here from DC right back there, Chris Robinson, who would be more than happy to answer all of your questions about joining SOF and getting involved in some of our exclusive programming in New York City. Tonight, we're here as part of the Conversation with Great Leaders series in memory of Preston Robert Tisch. The series began in 2009 as a way to feature leaders who are making a difference in their communities by the way they look at their work and their role in helping to build a civil society. In other words, they're building a world that we'd all like to be a part of. These leaders represent the values and commitment to public good that reflects the belief and work of the man honored by this series, Bob Tisch. His family, Steve Tisch, Lori Tisch, Lizzie and Jonathan Tisch, as well as the Lori M. Tisch Illumination Fund, generously make this series possible and help bring to you the wisdom and insight of leaders who are making a difference, like the man you're going to meet tonight. General Wesley Clark is a retired four-star general in the United States Army with a distinguished military career, Supreme Allied Commander and Commander-in-Chief of the U.S. European Command, where during the war in Kosovo, he led NATO forces to victory in Operation Allied Force. He is a member also of the Energy and Climate Advisory Board of the Clinton Global Initiative, head of a strategic consulting group, and an author of a number of books, including his most recent, Don't Wait for the Next War, which he'll be talking about this evening. And you'll have a chance to purchase and have it signed after the program upstairs. General Clark is also the recipient of a number of awards, including the Purple Heart and the Presidential Medal of Freedom. And our moderator tonight is also a very busy man. Jonathan Alter is an award-winning author, reporter, columnist, and TV reporter, TV analyst, and he's a longtime senior editor and columnist at Newsweek. Jonathan has written a number of publications, including the New York Times, the Washington Post, Vanity Fair, and the New Republic. And since 1996, he's been an analyst and contributing correspondent for NBC News and MSNBC. So now, I'd like to turn the program over to him. Jonathan?
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thanks to Jennifer Robb and Lori Tisch and the others who've made this possible. I feel like there's a little bit of a homecoming for me. I wrote a book about Franklin Roosevelt that came out, I guess, seven or eight years ago, and feel sort of imbued with the spirit of the Roosevelts whenever I come here, and it's just a wonderful place. Speaking of presidents, I also covered General Clark's 2004 campaign for president, and believed then and believe now that he would have made a very good one. And I think that this book is a testament to the breadth and depth of his intelligence and his, I would say, unparalleled understanding of the myriad problems that face this country in the 21st century. So this new book is just a tremendously impressive argument and extremely informative. But I need to ask you about, first, about, before we get to your strategy, which you have for this country, I need to start with some of the assumptions that lie behind the book, which I guess would be, why do we need some sort of grand strategy? Franklin Roosevelt, Theodore Roosevelt, other presidents have been, you know, flexible, pragmatic leaders who dealt with issues as they arose. Why do we need something more articulated?
Well, first of all, before I answer that question, I just want to thank you for being here and moderating and for those kind words about the book. And I want to thank the Tisch family for sponsoring this and hosting it and Hunter College. And I also want to thank the many people in this room who supported me and encouraged me to run for the president, gave money to my campaign, came to the rallies, and it was an incredible experience to go through this because I knew the military from 38 years in the armed forces. And then I wanted to become an investment banker, so I was licensed under NASD, which is now FINRA, and worked at Stevens, Inc. in Little Rock in private equity. And I got to learn broadcasting, not the way you did, but I had a contract with CNN, and I was on a lot, and Connie Chung once told me I had a good Q factor. And
she would know.
She sounded moderately jealous about this, and so I knew it must be true. And then I got to learn politics, and I had the 5-month run. We raised $24 million, and I learned a lot of tough lessons in this. But I met a lot of wonderful people. I got to go to 30 states. I got to see America the way few people can see it. And I was the favorite candidate for Panama, for example. They loved me in Panama because I ran. I was covered a lot in Europe on international television because they knew me from my NATO days. And after the campaign was over, I went back into the business community. I worked with Goldman Sachs in private equity. I was with James Lee Whitten, a consulting firm. I was with a little bank in New York that was basically a pipe shop where I learned the sort of hot money side of Wall Street. And I did international banking and international business and consulting in China, Eastern Europe, Africa, the Middle East, Western Europe. I meet heads of state. I know cybersecurity, energy. I'm on the boards of more companies than I should be, probably. But you get to ask a lot of dumb questions when you're a board member, and people have to answer you. And so I was lucky when I ran for president. I had guys like Gene Sperling and Bob Rubin and Ron Klain, who advised me. Jason Furman ran my policy shop, and look where he is today.
He's so chairman of the Council of Economic
Advisors. When I asked questions, I knew I was, you know, getting reliable answers. And so it was a tremendous vantage point and a great thing. And I was covered by a lot of really great people and decent people in the press, although I know you're not supposed to compliment the press because they take it as though they're not doing their job. Right. If you say, hey, great article, obviously they didn't dig hard enough. But
that's fake, by the way.
Okay.
They love it when you say
okay,
that.
Okay, great. But no, I always appreciated your work and the work of so many others who were there and trying to cover it. And I learned so much. And when I got out in the business community and after working through this, I began to see, I was happy we got out of Iraq. I ran for president because we shouldn't have been in Iraq. Well, it was a mistake. I knew it was a mistake, not only because I knew it, but because the generals who were on the inside told me it was a mistake. They couldn't say anything. If you're a general and the president tells you to go to war, you either resign or you say, I'll do it. But you may do it and you say, I think this is really dumb, but he's the boss. That's what civil-military relations is all about. So I knew all that from the inside. And sure enough, it worked out as badly as we thought. So, but then I began to go to China and talk to people in China. And I was with Goldman Sachs, and I looked at the financial crisis. And I looked at where the country was heading. And if you asked Americans on the street, said, are we going in the right direction? in poll after poll after poll, they always say no. But no one can define the right direction. So I started thinking about this historically, and I realized that usually we don't have a strategy unless there's a war, because it takes a war to pull this very diffuse and separated American political system together. Woodrow Wilson had an amazing strategy. Roosevelt tried to do a strategy during the Depression. It lasted for about less than 100 days, actually.
He didn't actually have a strategy,
yeah.
But that's
but
a
he didn't.
Different
but
question.
But, you know, people think he did with the 100 days
program.
He thought
he did, yeah.
But it actually, he
know,
didn't last.
There's just, I've got to just interrupt and throw in this, because we're in the House of Roosevelt, Roosevelt's house. So in this house, where we are right now, Roosevelt was handling his transition as he became president in late 1932 and early 1933, and all the various cabinet nominees would come over here. Meanwhile, there were hungry people outside, mobs, and they had security as they would leave sometimes. And Raymond Moley was his top aide, who was sitting here with him, you know, going over various cabinet choices. And he later said, to say that the New Deal was a plan would be like saying that a little boy's bedroom full of broken toys,
yeah,
baseball bats, and old, you know, uniforms,
yeah,
what had been,
yeah,
put there by an interior decorator.
Yeah. No, you're exactly right. And when I was writing this book, I went back and worked, yeah, this. And, you know, he took a bunch of ideas. Some were leftover ideas from the Progressive Era. Some were ideas Hoover had tried to implement.
Right.
And he had this window of time where Americans were scared. But as soon as that window passed, the forces of division in American society reasserted themselves. And when Roosevelt tried to pack the Supreme Court, even lost his Democrat support. But World War II came along. And once again, boom, the country came together.
Right.
At the strategy we had when I was growing up was Ike's strategy. In his inaugural in 1953, Ike said, "We Democrats and Republicans don't agree on everything, but we have to pull together because we've seen the ultimate evil on the outside." He's talking about communism, how it overran Eastern Europe, and it had taken over China, and it wanted to take over the world, and now they had nuclear weapons, and Americans were fighting in Korea. The American definition of a national strategy for me is, it's something in a couple of sentences that you can describe that helps point the country in the direction in which it should work, both internally and externally. It doesn't eliminate partisan conflict, but it helps shape it, restrain it, and mold it in a certain direction. And every president during the Cold War used one version or another of Ike's strategy. It basically, there was always a Soviet Union out there, and, you know, Democrats always believe you should rely more on being the nice guy, and can't we see it from their point of view, and can't we restrain them with legal agreements? And Republicans are always like, these guys, you got to have weapons, and you got to be tough, and they don't trust weakness. But it was enough that there was a partisan divide, but it came together on the importance. And if you asked the people in America, and you said, what are we doing here? They said, we got to stop communism. It was
right.
About that simple. And then we did. We won. And when we stopped it, we lost our strategy. And we had a great decade in the 1990s. I was there in the joint staff, and in the book I recount how Shali Kashvili called me in and asked me, says, Wes, in his Polish accent, very smart guy, says, Wes, what is our strategy? And I've been on the job like a week, and I thought it was like an exam. And he was going to test me to see whether he's going to fire me or not. You know, he was a 4-star, I just made 3 stars. I was not secure in my position, and I said, sir, I honestly, I don't know. I mean, I'd worked for Al Haig, and the strategy was to counter the relentless growth of Soviet military power. And I went to Shali, I said, sir, I don't know. He says, I don't know either. And they keep asking on the Hill. And so nobody knew what the strategy was. So,
enlargement, right?
So,
which that was the Clinton administration's
strategy?
Yeah,
I mean, we published a strategy, okay? It was called a national strategy.
Engagement and enlargement.
It sounds like an advertisement for a men's pharmaceutical
right.
product, right?
Exactly.
And, but nobody read it because even though if you read it today, you say, damn, those people were smart. You know, we defined the problem of proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, regional instability, terrorism and transnational problems, and the resurgence of Russia as the four main challenges. And we said we're going to support democratic regimes, fight only as a last resort, and fight with allies when we can, and unilaterally only if we must. And it was a brilliant document. Nobody read it. It did not shape the debate on public policy. It did not guide the commitment of resources. It did not rest in the mind of the American people. So if you went to people on the street in 1997 and said, what are we doing in the world? What's America about today? They couldn't have told you. And then 9/11 happened. Boom, the country came together because it was a war. We waited for a war. And George W. Bush was quick to take advantage of it. Colin Powell set it up.
Tell the Wolfowitz story, because their strategy had been cooking for 10
years. There was a strategy, okay? So it was 1991. It was May. I didn't get to fight in the Gulf War. I tried. You know, I was a one-star general. I was commanding Fort Irwin, the National Training Center. I just looked like some ambitious general trying to force his way into somebody else's war. And, you know, when you're a sergeant, they say, Sergeant, that's great. When you're a general, they say, General, you're assigned here. You do your job and keep your mouth shut. So I said, yes, sir. So I didn't get to fight. And at the end of the war, I was up in Washington. I was running training on helping people go to the war, but I didn't get there. At the end of the war, I got into to Washington one day. Paul Wolfowitz had been out to visit me at the National Training Center in January of 1991 when we were training the National Guard. Paul said, come to see me sometime when you come to Washington. You and I are about the same age. We'd been at a few conferences. I went in to see him. It was a Friday afternoon, warm day in May. Everybody's kind of dozing and thinking about, boy, weren't we great in Iraq? They're planning the victory parade down Constitution Avenue. And so I called up to the office, and Scooter Libby came to the door and invited me in. And he said, yeah, the secretary will see you now. And I go back, and there's Wolfowitz sort of groggy at his desk. He's looking at something.
And he's Deputy Secretary
he's
of
Undersecretary
Defense.
He's Undersecretary of Policy, which is the number three position, and he's the brainchild of the Pentagon.
Under Cheney.
Under Cheney.
Right.
Right.
Secretary
and so,
of Defense.
And so I say, Mr. Secretary, he looks at me like, you know, who is this guy? And I knew that. You know, I mean, why would he remember me? Just because he'd been out there for a couple of days. I said, well, you know, you came out and visited me at NDC, and I just wanted to say, you must be really proud of how well the troops have done in the Gulf War. He said, yeah, he said, but, you know, we didn't get Saddam. Now, he said, President Bush over in the White House thinks his own people are going to overthrow him. He says, I don't think so. He said, but we did learn a couple of things. We learned that we can use force with impunity, and the Soviets won't stop us. And we've got 5, maybe 10 years to get rid of these old Soviet surrogate regimes like Iraq and Syria before the next superpower comes along and challenges us in the region. That's a strategy.
Yeah.
That's a strategy. I said, well, who's the next superpower? Who do you think? Is it China? He said, could be. I said, well, but only 5 to 10 years? He said, nobody knows. And he sort of dreamily, he sort of muttered a couple of few things. I sort of got the idea that was it. That was all I was going to get. I said, thanks a lot. Great to see you. But it stuck. And after Sholley asked me that question, 3 years later, I was now a three-star, responsible for the military portion of the national strategy, or at least for writing it and thinking about it. And I went around to the guy who had taken Wolfowitz's position. I said, we don't have a strategy. I said, what about the Wolfowitz strategy? He said, what's that? I said, you know, that we're going to use force and we're going to throw out these old, he says, never heard of it.
Rogue state rollback.
Yeah.
But 10 years later.
But it came back.
Yeah, so 10 years later, on the weekend after 9/11, you heard something very interesting, just a few days after 9/11.
Yeah, well, I mean, I was in the Pentagon a couple of days after 9/11, and a guy called me down and said, I couldn't stay away from the Pentagon. I was on CNN every day, and I was wearing a business suit, and there was no green uniform, there was no black stripe, there was nobody to tell me the intel. They said, General Clark, who do you think did it? I said, I think Osama bin Laden did it. But no one was there to say, General, we got these intercepts, look at this, this proves it. So, you know, I wanted to go see Mother Pentagon and say to Rumsfeld and Wolfowitz, who was now the deputy, am I doing okay on CNN? Do you think it's what I'm saying is the right thing? Am I saying stuff that's wrong? Not that I was necessarily going to change, but I wanted some feedback. They said, you're doing fine. As I was leaving, I stopped in to say hello to a couple of generals on the joint staff. They said, sir, come in here. I said, no, you don't have time. They said, come in here. I said, we're going to attack Iraq. I said, we're going to attack Iraq. Why? The guy says, sir, I don't know. He said, I guess because we're not very good at dealing with terrorism, but we think we're pretty good at taking out governments, and this is all we know to do. So we bombed Afghanistan. I was back in the Pentagon about 6 weeks later. I said, knocked on the same guy's door. I said, you told me we were going to attack Iraq. What are we doing? He said, sir, it's worse than that. Look at this memo. I said, is that classified memo? He said, yeah, it's from upstairs in policy shop. I said, okay, don't show it to me. He said, it says we're going to attack, we're going to take out seven states in 5 years. It's Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and Iran. I said, God, this sounds familiar. And I went back to the Wolfowitz conversation of 1991. There was an effort to put together a strategy. It's a crazy strategy, totally misunderstood the region. But that's the strategy we started down in 2001.
But do we need a crisis to have a strategy? Your argument in this book is no, that we can have sort of the moral equivalent of war, as William right. James called it.
Yeah.
Jimmy Carter, when he was popular at the beginning of his administration, hauled out that moral equivalent of war idea on energy, as you do in this book. And, you know, William Safire immediately dubbed it meow. And basically, you know, the reaction was a little bit like the reaction to the strategic plan that you put together under Clinton. Without the urgency,
that's right.
It was really hard to get people focused. Yeah. So before we get to what your plan is, and it's very well articulated, how do you deal with the lack of urgency problem?
Yeah. Well, I think that, you know, I did debate. I took a speech class in the 12th grade, and I learned that when you're putting a debate proposition together and you're the first affirmative, you have to create, in the first part of your debate, you have to explain the need for whatever your proposition is that you're defending. What's the need? You have to build it up. In those days, it was the need for federal action to improve higher education. But here, there is a need. It's not exactly that the Nazis are about to overrun us, but there are five really powerful long-term challenges that we're confronting, that if we don't deal with these successfully, in 30 years, this country won't be recognizable to us. Those five challenges all have, they're all a set. They all kind of fit together, and they're all interrelated. It's terrorism, cybersecurity, financial system stability, the ascent of China, managing that ascent so it's within the framework of the international system, and climate change.
Before we go, and we're going to deal with all five of them, but before we do, I want to ask you why a nuclear Iran was not one of them.
Because we've got a nuclear North Korea, a nuclear Pakistan, a nuclear India. We know that countries in the Middle East and the region are building nuclear reactors like the United Arab Emirates. Why are they doing that? The proliferation genie is out of the bottle. And Iran, even if we get an agreement, they will end up in the same position as Japan, a nuclear energy country which has lots of technology, lots of money, and if it ever wants a nuclear weapon, could pop it pretty quickly. Look, counter-proliferation, proliferation control has worked for a long time. From the time we first established a nuclear non-proliferation treaty till now, we've avoided a nuclear holocaust. We've slowed the spread of nuclear weapons. We rolled back the program, South Africa, Brazil, South Korea. We've retarded the program, Iran. Even North Korea for a little while, Iraq, Syria. So we're slowing it. You're not going to get rid of it because there's too much leakage of technology and education around the world. So you've got to work the other conditions. A nuclear-armed Iran, yes, it's very bad if you believe that Israel's only defense is to attack, and you believe that Iran might put the area surrounding Israel under the umbrella of an extended deterrence, and credibly say to Israel, you drop one bomb on my friend Bashar Assad or Hezbollah in Lebanon, we will destroy you. And then you're into not deterrence, but then you're into Israeli defense. But we're already there. We're spending money on anti-missile missiles, and there's a lot of different programs. If you can slow it down, it's a good thing. But an Iranian nuclear weapon is unlikely to change the course of the West in the way that inattention to these five problems will.
But if there's a national security crisis, isn't it most likely to be related to Iran and the Middle East?
Not necessarily, no. But my view on this is that you explain to the American people what these challenges are. You then come up with the first affirmative case in debate. You present your program to deal with these challenges. And you build up America's strength so then you can handle the crisis that comes along. What is the crisis? Is it Ebola? Boko Haram? North Korean attack on Japan? A Chinese attack on Okinawa or Taiwan? Something that goes wrong in the Middle East? Is it Russia with a breakthrough in Ukraine and the impact on the European Union? Or is it Greece leaving the EU and suddenly there's a worldwide depression? Or the Fed with $4.3 trillion in debt can't handle it, and suddenly people lose confidence in the American dollar and the value of the dollar collapses? Now, any of those things, or a meteor striking,
right,
in Texas, or the great volcano in Yellowstone could be a crisis.
So you're talking here about a structure that takes us beyond headlines.
That's right.
To the deeper, more enduring challenges.
Right. In other words, I'm seeking the antidote for CNN headline news, Fox News, and MSNBC, Rachel Maddow, and Chris Matthews, and the rest. I'm seeking... like these people. They're all my friends. But they make money off the crisis of the moment. But that's not the way you can lead and govern and build a country. Eisenhower recognized in the 1950s that however urgent the threat of the Soviet Union, nuclear-armed with ICBMs, was, the greatest strength America had was not its armed forces. It was the productive power of the U.S. economy. And you couldn't bankrupt America in an effort to build an overpowering national defense system at the expense of employment, jobs, and growth of the economy.
So now you say that we have he talked about the military industrial complex. Now you say we have a security industrial complex. Right. What do you mean?
No, I say where we need to go is an energy security complex. But what we have right now is Ike built the military industrial complex. And everybody quotes that passage from his farewell address where he says, beware of the power that, but he knew we needed it. He's just warning us, be careful with it. You couldn't keep up with the Soviet Union if you didn't do something extraordinary to supercharge private investment in national security defense. And what we got out of it was this huge legacy of integrated circuits and lasers and transistors and the internet. And much of the growth of the U.S. economy over the last 20 years is a result of spending on the military and technology, R&D, that went on during the Eisenhower, Nixon, Johnson, and
Let me stop you right there again before we get, and we're going to have time, plenty of time, to get to the specific remedies. But you just listed major industries that are at the foundation of our economy, and all of them were either created or nurtured by the federal government.
That's right.
Now, this is something that we have one political party in this country right now.
It's true.
That believes is not true.
It's true.
They don't believe that government has any role in creating jobs or establishing new industries. So are they just historically ignorant? Is that what you're suggesting here?
Well,
when you list all of these industries that were established by the government?
They're not historically ignorant. They're politically expedient. In other words, if one party controls and represents government, and that government thrives on taxation, and if you can create the intellectual foundation of an argument that says the country's better off with less taxation, and that means you need to cut spending, that means kill the beast, so to speak, in Republican parlance, then you might get elected. It's what Newt Gingrich discovered, and it's what's really changed American politics. That is, you don't have to go along to get along on Capitol Hill. You can actually come to Capitol Hill and say no to everything and still be reelected. And your constituents won't hold you responsible. You didn't deliver a single bridge, new courthouse, interstate highway, nothing. But you said you were against gun control, abortion rights, and new taxes. And by God, you were 100% consistent on it, and I want your money. These big businesses, I want your money because I stood up for you. No more taxes. And seems to work in many of these gerrymandered congressional districts. The politics of the country changes back and forth. But what I believe is that the one argument that even sells Republicans is the function of the government to maintain security. Now, they like fences to do this. But these five challenges I've laid out, you can't solve them with a single technology. You can't declare war against them. You can't build a fence around America. They're not delegable to the private sector alone. They have to be public, private, international. They all take money and resources. People have to spend money on it, both private industry and government. They take some technology. They take some leadership. And they're long-term. And they're going to last beyond the incumbency of Barack Obama or the next president after that or the next one after that. They form a foundation where leaders and voters can say, what is the strategy, and demand something in terms of the protection of America from the people who want to take political office, rather than saying, what are your values? Because when you become a value-based political party and you have one party contending against another, it's real hard to compromise on values. It's like you always ask me in the debate, and Adam Nagorny and other people, it's like, well, do you believe in a woman's right to choose? I'd say, yes. What about this Supreme Court ruling? What about that one? Do you believe in, what about after 9 months? What about partial?
That wasn't me. That was Adam.
But there were a lot of people who did.
I know.
And the point is that when you become a values-based democracy, you lose the thrust and the ability to, in a federalist system with checks and balances and separation of powers, to take the government forward. What I'm trying to offer in an indirect way is a series of problems that will pull the electorate out of values to worry about the supreme value of the protection of the United States of America for our children and grandchildren.
Okay. So your strategy is what you call an energy-enabled strategy.
Correct.
E2S.
Right.
Easy to remember. What does energy enabled mean, and why is energy at the centerpiece,
You know, in 1972, the Club of Rome published its findings and said that by the year 2000, we'd be out of oil. Well, they were wrong. We're not out of oil. Oil is the predominant commodity in international trade. It's at the foundation of 20th century science, technology, and industry. It's the biggest, if you look at the most valuable assets in the world, at least at the price of $80 or $100 a barrel, it's oil reserves. They were worth last summer, $130+ trillion. And the largest companies in the world are oil companies. So as much as the president said we need to get to electric power, and he wanted a million electric-powered cars on the road by this year, the technology's not there, the marketing forces are not there, and people like they like their Mustangs and their big SUVs and their four-wheel drives. And, you know, I drive a little sports car, and people look down. I said, look at that old guy driving that little car. Why didn't he want a big car like me? The bigger, the better. And they're buying them right now. So you can't quite get away from oil. But if you were going to try to look at this country and say, what does this country need? It needs economic growth. It needs real job creation, not Burger King jobs, but jobs that involve high-skilled workmen who build things and change the country.
Okay, so you want to get there through energy independence.
Yeah, because
with a carbon tax. Because we have a very sophisticated audience.
I know that.
So let's get down to some of the solutions. Carbon tax, sovereign wealth fund, public-private partnerships lead to strategic planning for internationally.
Yeah.
Tell us how some of these things would work. One that was the freshest to me is this, we've had a lot of debates about a carbon tax, and we know that how politically difficult it is, even if it's necessary. A sovereign wealth fund. I'd never really thought about why we don't have one, and what advantage would it be if we did?
Well, just think about it. I mean, you know, in 1983, Alan Greenspan led the Social Security Reform Commission. They raised the rates on Social Security. And for 20 years, we ran this huge Social Security surplus. You know what we did with it? We invested in debt. So we had what was called a unified budget, and we could overrun tax collections because we could finance it by taking money from that Social Security Trust Fund. Of course, we wrote IOUs, and everything was totally legal on this. But what if we'd taken that Social Security surplus and said, you know, rather than just underwriting the general revenue debt, we're going to actually invest this with private enterprise and public-private partnerships at home and abroad and get a return on the money that's higher than the actual T-bill rate. Now, countries do this all over the world. Norway is the prime example. They've got $70, $80 billion in their sovereign wealth fund, and they use it to not only get a return for their retirement programs and other things, but they use it to promote Norwegian business and employment.
Well, has it ever come up in Congress? What's the argument against it?
The general argument of probably against big government. And by, you know, there's a million questions like, you know, who administers it? How much profit does it take? Where does it take that money from? But here's the telling argument, Jonathan. Texas, don't mess with Texas. But Texas has the equivalent of a sovereign wealth fund. They call it Rick Perry's slush fund. And they say he just favors the companies he likes. And there's stories where they've made mistakes with the investment. But most states in America have a strategy. They want to attract investment, outside investment. They want to grow. In Arkansas, we tried really hard to get wind energy companies there, even though we hate wind in Arkansas because we don't have any, except for a little hot air sometimes. It's not there. But it was a moderately successful strategy. We'd love to have an automobile company, a plant. But Alabama is one of the winners with automobile plants in the South. They have a strategy. Give us more Mercedes plants. We like them. So we can't get them. States have strategies. Why can't the country have a strategy? It's politically difficult. But if you're going to compete with China for influence in Africa, the way it works is like this. You go in to see the government of South Sudan. You're an American entrepreneur, maybe a retired flag officer from the armed forces. You say, understand you guys got some oil. I said, General, you're welcome to be here. We love you. And yes, we're friendly to America, and we do have oil resources. We'd like to build you a pipeline. I said, oh, I'm sure with your leadership capacity, you could certainly do that. Do you have any money? I said, well, no, but we can go on the market in London. And I'm sure we can get some people who will invest in building this pipeline in Africa. So you don't actually have any money yourself. Said, no, well, no, but I mean, we'll make a profit out of this.
But the Chinese said, do.
The Chinese come in the next day.
Right, of course.
And they say, do you have any money? I said, of course, the Bank of China is behind this. And we will provide full engineering support.
They're even going into Chicago and rebuilding the sewage system in Chicago,
sure.
Chinese investors.
I was in Ethiopia last year in Addis Ababa. You could hardly get around town because the Chinese are everywhere. They're tearing up the streets. They're putting subway systems in. It's amazing what they're doing all over Africa.
Okay.
They're buying friends and winning influence and making money. Imagine that. So if we had a sovereign wealth fund, you can't imagine how good American entrepreneurs are. And there's $7 trillion in debt out there, and that's $4 million at the Fed, a couple of trillion on Wall Street, a couple of trillion in American corporations. Desperate entrepreneurs who want to build things who can't get financing. If we had that sovereign wealth fund, you could go into a country like Romania with $5 million to get something started, prove that it was workable and financeable, and then bring commercial financing in behind it. But without that sovereign wealth fund to take the risk to get it going, stuff just sort of goes in circles. So that's part of what we need in Eastern Europe and in Africa as an economic instrument of freedom and democracy. Because on the other side of that are powers that are not necessarily friendly to the United States, who are winning friends and buying influence by playing their own game. In Eastern Europe, Russian money's everywhere, corruption, companies, banks. Bulgaria, Russians invested, bought 10% of a bank, and when Bulgaria did something Russia didn't like, they pulled their money out of that bank. There was a run on the bank. The economy just about collapsed because the bank had a lot of government deposits in it. It's economic warfare out there.
So on China, one of the things you do that so well is you explain how these five challenges are all interrelated. So on China, you talk about your remedy is to not prepare for war, because you don't think that, despite what's going on in the South China Sea, that's really what is the immediate threat. It's to integrate them into what you call the global architecture. What do you mean by that?
Well, I mean, we created this architecture at the end of World War II. It's the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, the United Nations, the International Court System, the Hague Tribunal on War Crimes. It's the way you adjudicate international disputes. Chinese, they're not particularly fond of Western law, because in the 19th century, the Chinese emperor was required to sign some treaties that ended up chopping China to pieces and ultimately destroyed China. So it's not in their culture to make binding legal agreements. They just don't see it that way. And it's in their culture to be the center of world civilization. So as they become more powerful, four times our population, their GDP is not as large as ours is yet. Spending power, purchasing power parity, it may be about equal. They've got a lot more disposable government capital than we do, because they don't take care of the people the same way, and the people don't have the same living standards. But they are going to grow, and they're going to see the world through their own eyes and their own interests. So it's just natural. They're not going to want to kowtow to an IMF that operates out of New York and Paris, or a World Bank that's located in Washington that does everything the United States says. They're not going to be happy with a UN Security Council and an international financial system that basically runs out of New York and London. They're going to want to see power shift to Beijing and Shanghai. They're going to want to be more comfortable in their own environment. How do we bridge this gap short of conflict? Because in history, almost every time a rising power suddenly emerges and looks at the existing structure, it has to fight its way in. That was the story of the First World War. So we know that we and China could come to blows. I mean, even though we're great trading partners, so were France and Germany before the First World War. It didn't stop that from happening. People said it would, but it didn't. So we have to be careful on working China. We've got to help them see their interests as being more congruent with our interests without giving up on the structure itself. And that means when China comes to you and says, let's you and me work together. You know, we got a lot more in common than you would ever have with Japan. So what do you care about those Ryukyu Islands for? You know, you should be working with China. We're the most powerful country here. If you say that and you work that condominium of bilateral interest the way that China has actually proposed it several times, you'll end up undercutting the structure of the international system that's provided the foundation for international development, growth, and the longest period of peace in the history of modern mankind.
Since the book came out, there's been the deal on climate change, which is another one of your big challenges, which we'll talk about in the question and answer period. Is that a big deal, the Obama deal with China on climate change, for the purposes that we're talking about, for reintegrating them?
I think it's a nice step forward. You know, whether it's enforced and whether it's followed through on or not, it's still an agreement. And to get the United States and China to agree on something that can be done by executive action rather than running through a Congress with essentially the majority members of Congress can't quite bring themselves to admit the reality of climate change and therefore don't want to support it.
So in the same way that education was sold as a national defense issue, and that's how we got first real aid to education in the late 50s, started investing, and the payoff has been unbelievable. Should climate change now be redefined as what you call a force multiplier of instability? That, you know, climate change is I think the chairman of the Joint Chiefs said that it was a major security challenge. So should that be a kind of nomenclature framing discussion that we should have now, where instead of climate change being talked of in terms of tree huggers, it should be talked of in terms of preventing wars?
Absolutely. But you can look at climate change through many lenses. I was having dinner with Maxine Waters a couple of years ago. I said, this congresswoman from California, I said, what are you working on? What's the most important issue you've got? She said, flood insurance. You know, the federal government subsidizes insurance and coastlines, and how much you subsidy and so forth. It's a huge budget item when you have to pay off, like after Hurricane Sandy. And so how do you actually raise the rates on people that are in zones where they could be flooded out, and how much does that cost? So you could look at this through an economic lens and say, you know, you've got trillions of dollars of potential liability out there. You've got to prepare for it now. So it has an economic impact, it has an employment impact, it has a national security impact, it has a health impact. So there's a lot of different lenses to look at it through.
Okay, we got about, 10 minutes left. Any questions that, yes, over there.
I'm gonna try to answer these really quick.
Okay.
General, you seem to imply that we took care of Syria and their nuclear proliferation. Was it really the United States? I mean, who took
it
out there?
Well, the Israelis bombed it. We knew about it. And Bashar Assad is trying to put it back in place, apparently.
Since you're right next door, that's fine. Go ahead.
Well, you talk about the United States going in to do business with places like Africa and China and helping, you know, but we have laws that say that if we as the United States go into a country and we do business, we have to do business the way it's done in the United States. These countries tend to be very corrupt. We cannot compete with other countries that don't have these laws. So as long as we have these laws that require us to behave in a manner that we behave here in the United States, and we go into a different culture and we don't behave in their manner, we can't do well.
It's true that the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act does inhibit some American businesses from competing head-on-head against, let's say, a business that can do a payoff to a local official. But in a larger sense, most of these governments, qua government, would rather be associated with the United States and American business than with a corrupt foreign business and their government. For the simple reason that you don't know what anybody's price is. And once that price starts getting paid, you don't know what the impact is on the government. So when I go to these countries, it's true. There's a lot of corruption in these countries. And when you're an American businessman, you've got to be really careful with it. But the United States has worked pretty well with allies. We've found some of this corruption. We've exposed it. We've made it much more difficult. And look, when I travel across the United States, there's hardly a state I go into that if I pick up a local paper, I don't find some evidence of corruption in the United States. In our home state of Arkansas, our good Democratic Party state treasurer, 68 years old, was convicted and sentenced to prison for directing state bonds to a certain bond agency that paid her like $1,000 extra per month. It's incredible. And you look at it and you say, God, this can't be true in America, but it is. Or it's like one of my friends said to me. He said, there's some states and some counties that I wouldn't want to build a highway there. You know, so we're always really mindful of corruption. U.S. embassies are on guard about it. But what I see from our foreign services, they don't understand business and they don't see enough about their own country. It's like, you know, we're holier than thou. The truth is, every nation has to deal with corruption. And we may be a little bit better marginally than the worst, but we have our own challenges, believe me.
Wes, one of your five pillars is cyber. What does your strategy suggest we should be doing more than we're doing now?
Well, business has to put money into this, and government has to take the lead in extending a cyber shield around the country. Right now, the U.S. Cyber Command only protects the U.S. government. And so a private industry, where all the innovation is, where all the secrets are, where the banks have all the money, they run to NSA and say, I got hacked. Yeah, and there's a lot of collaboration, but actually the U.S. government's not responsible for protecting your money in J.P. Morgan. And when the Russians come in to recon it, and I think it was J.P. Morgan the Russians hacked into a couple of months ago, that's the rumor around Washington at least, they went deep inside the bank's system. Now, they didn't change any numbers, but they reconned the system by cyber. Now imagine if you just saw a row of ones and zeros and you changed every 20th one or zero to the opposite. What you would do to the world economy if you did that to J.P. Morgan. And apparently the Russians went inside. Now that's a national security threat, first order. Businesses don't want to have to be involved with government on cybersecurity unless they want to do it. Banks don't want to report their vulnerabilities. They don't want to report their losses. They don't want to report, because you invest in a bank because you're confident in the bank. What if you knew that bank was hit by 40 different thefts through cyber? You might move your deposit. So you need some legislation to protect people, to encourage information sharing, and businesses need to pay. The way we say it is, you pay by the number of seats for cyber protection. And let the U.S. government worry about cyber. Somebody told me when the Iranians went in the summer of 2013 and they went after one of the online banks, I think it was Citibank, and they shut down online banking with a directed denial of service attack, we did nothing. There are three explanations for this. One said, well, it didn't really do any harm to the bank because all they did was shut down online banking for 3 or 4 days. Didn't lose any actual money because the money still came in later. Another one said, no, that wasn't it. We didn't do anything because it was private property. Well, okay. So, but if the Barbary pirates had cruised the shores of Long Island and lobbed some 5-pound cannonballs at those $30 million mansions out there, I bet we'd have done something about that, even though it was private property. And the third was the most frightening. Said, we don't want to retaliate against the Iranians because we don't actually know how good they are. And they didn't do any damage now, but they could have, maybe. And if we start this tit for tat going back and forth, we may be the losers. So we've got a big gray area. We don't understand it. And the Republican Party in Congress has fought for years to prevent the kind of comprehensive information sharing and national leadership we need to protect the country from cyber threats. It's time to move past that.
You say that we could even have return addresses. If we could get over the privacy issues, we could have internet protocols that require return addresses. Could that be done with a turnkey operation almost? I mean,
you'd have to have complicity from governments around the world. People have to agree with it. You'd have to invest
for
it.
But I mean, if you had an international treaty that required return addresses.
Sure.
And you got signatories to that.
Sure, but you know what would happen?
Is that fairly easy to implement?
Probably not, because when you proposed that and you went to the United States government, you went to the National Security Council, there'd be some general there from National Security Agency, say, Mr. President, said, I know you're worried about this, but believe me, if you give us some money, we'll protect this country. But if you sign that treaty and you lock us in where we can't do the kind of cyber reconnaissance we need to be doing, you're going to leave this country unprepared in the event of an unanticipated cyber attack. We're going to lose the advantage that we as America have in this field, and you're exposing us to national and international catastrophe. And that will be the end of the international agreement. Now, I don't know that that discussion's happened yet, but I know that discussion.
But right now, they're not protecting us. I mean, we just got a briefing at the Council on Foreign Relations from a guy who knew what he was talking about, had been inside the U.S. government at a senior level on this issue, and he said, if they can imagine it, they can do it, if they have the resources.
That's exactly right. Anything that's being done by software can be undone by software.
We're defenseless right now.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
As a citizen, who would you like to see as the next president of the United States, and why?
Well, Mr. Moderator, can I answer that question?
Sure.
Is it within the spirit of the program?
Of course.
Look, I'm a Democrat, okay? I'm for the little guy. I think that there's always exceptional people, there's always exceptional businesses. They'll always find a way to make a profit and do good for the community. But there's a lot of wonderful people out there who just didn't get the equal opportunity start that other people did. So I'm in favor of small business. I'm in favor of people who have the brains to go to college but can't afford it, people who want to take care of a home but can't afford to buy it, et cetera. So I'm a Democrat. And I think there's not been any candidate in recent American political history who's more prepared to assume leadership in the United States than former Secretary of State and Senator Hillary Clinton. And that's who I support.
Yeah.
Energy security. What is happening now with OPEC and the sort of brinkmanship with them against the U.S. shale drillers? And how do you think that's going to play out? Is it more economical or is it more political in terms of them trying to sort of weaken Iran?
Well, it's both. But you know, in the financial business, and there's a lot of finance in the oil business, once things start to roll, they take a momentum and life of their own. There was an imbalance this summer in the oil markets. And the demand for oil is, in the short term, it's highly inelastic. People can only consume so much and store so much. So once the financial markets get a whiff of that and prices start to go down, they short oil. And that accelerates the downward trend. I think when that started happening, the Saudis had to ask themselves, what should we be doing about this? We're the ones who maintain OPEC. And the answer was about several things. Number one, we tried to do this before, and we kept cutting price, and all we did was lose market share. Number two, this shale stuff makes us real nervous. We don't understand it, number one. Number two, we like the fact that America's dependent on imported oil. You know, President Roosevelt promised that he would always protect us if we would provide security for America's oil needs. And ISIS is coming right at us. It's true, some of our money went into creating ISIS. It's true that ISIS espouses the same interpretation of Sharia law that our Wahhabi imams do, but we need some good protection from ISIS. If America's energy independent, why will it have an interest in protecting us? So I think there was economic factors, political factors, risk factors. They said, look, we tried to break Iran in 2005 by reducing the price of oil below $40. We failed. Maybe get another whack at this with Iran. And by the way, maybe the Americans and the Brits will thank us for reducing the price of oil because maybe it'll hurt Russia. So there are a lot of reasons behind this. And then they started asking, what is the price of oil that we have to get down to really take a whack out of that shale thing? The shale thing really makes us nervous. What, $80? Somebody said, no, I think it might be lower than that. Said, but you've been saying $80, and that's what gets that oil flowing. Yeah, but that was then. $70? $60? $50? So I'm on the board of one of these little oil companies. We're still pumping oil. It's $45. We're still making something like $2 million a month.
Will it stay low enough to assure Hillary Clinton of winning?
You know, there's a big difference now than what happened before. Because if you look at America's job growth since 2009, the engine building behind that job growth has been shale. It's not only in oil, it's in steel, it's manufacturing, it's cheap gas, it's companies in the petrochemical area coming back into the United States. If you stop that energy development, as it's stopping right now with 17,000, 20,000, 40,000 layoffs a month and people being fired from these companies, this economy is going to unwind.
But how about, aren't you going to have a consumer? I mean, if every American right now is getting a $1,000 tax cut and they're going out and spending that, we're already seeing signs
sure.
of it.
But the marginal propensity to consume of the 80% of the American population used to be like 0.98. We saved nothing. But some people actually learned lessons from 2008. And what they learned was, A, you can't put all your money in a house, and B, you better have some rainy day money. So our marginal propensity to consume has gone down a little bit. And when people start losing their jobs, 16% of the high yield debt in the United States today is associated with oil and gas. Now, that debt is marked to market. It's based on the value of the reserves or the value of what they call the net back in these oil companies, the difference between what you actually sell the product for and what your costs are. So if when oil goes from like $95 to $45 and it costs you $30 to produce it, your net back falls not by 50%, but by 70%. And insofar as that debt is associated with your net back, that debt is now worth 25 cents on the dollar. And when people who've invested in high yield debt lose money and they market to market, they start selling other assets to compensate for their losses. That's required. And so there's a contagion in the marketplace.
You should write a piece about why lower oil prices are not actually good for the economy.
I've been thinking about it, but every time I go to Yahoo Business, there's somebody writing about it.
Okay. You can find it anywhere. Okay, I think we have time for one more. Yes.
I just had a question. So it looks like we kind of pulled out of, I know you didn't like Iraq, but we pulled out, which I think was a mistake, all of our troops, and now we have ISIS, and at some point, we're going to have to deal with it. What do you think, how is that going to get resolved? And what do you think the issues and challenges are right now?
Okay, well, in 30 seconds or less, this is a really tough question. It's one of my five big challenges. We're going to have the problem of terrorism with us for a long time because the problem of the Islamic identity in the modern world has been with us for 300 years. One of the three principal ways of dealing with it is by going back to Muhammad's lifestyle. That's the Wahhabi approach. And that Wahhabi approach provides the fertile ground for recruiting Islamic zealots who are willing to fight and die for the 72 virgins and the glory of martyrdom. So we're not going to cure this in the near term. ISIS is just one manifestation. But ISIS is not just about radical Islam, and it's actually not in Iraq. ISIS is a product of funding by Saudi Arabia and Qatar. That funding started in 2006. It was in Lebanon. It grew in 2010 when we tried to provide money to fight Bashar Assad. And the money went everywhere. And that money and recruits came with direction from certain governments in the region. Now, you may recall that Vice President Biden recently apologized to the government of Turkey for asserting that the government of Turkey might have had something to do with this. So you'll have to make that assessment yourself. But think of it this way. Turkey has geostrategic pretensions in the region. After all, they're the heirs of the Ottoman Empire. And Erdogan is a great and charismatic modern Islamic leader who's overturning the secularist legacy of Ataturk. And he's looking forward to new leadership with this dynamic economy of 90 million people in Turkey. Do you think he wants to be hemmed in by an alliance of Iran and Syria that separates him? Do you think he wants a hostile Iraq on his southern border? No. So do you think that ISIS might be like Frankenstein was, a sort of deliberate creation, and then a monster that got out of control? If we'd stayed in Iraq, we would have had no grip on ISIS unless we went inside Syria. ISIS went inside Iraq because it was available at that point and because it served in the gossip of the region on the Arab street the interests of certain powers who were not aligned with Prime Minister Maliki. And they were successful because Maliki was overthrown. They didn't succeed in kicking Iran out of Iraq. But so when you look at this, there's a lot more than meets the eye to it. And the basic strategy is you got to work with local allies on the ground. You got to use U.S. air power. You got to do it in a sustainable fashion. No big ground invasions. There are you can't do it with air power alone. If you ask the generals, they'll tell you you need ground forces. But what the generals don't say often enough is ground forces are necessary but not sufficient component for success. The sufficient component is governance. And I think we established pretty conclusively that even if you occupy an Islamic country in the Middle East, like Iraq, with 140,000 forces, with the most modern technology, with the spending billions of dollars per month to keep them there, even if you turn the country upside down, kick 2 million people out of it, kill 100 or 200,000 people in the process, you may be able to eradicate violence in some limited areas for a certain period of time, but you cannot provide governance. We failed with Maliki in providing stable, democratic, Western-oriented, terrorist-opposing governance in Iraq. And putting U.S. forces in there again won't provide that governance. So we got to be prepared for a long-term problem. ISIS can be contained, it can be obstructed, it can be resisted. We can work it on the political, the diplomatic, the economic, the cultural, the religious, and the military level. But what you can't do is make the mistake of saying you can declare war on ISIS, send in the Marines, clean this out. It won't happen. It's like going after the roaches in the closet by sprinkling some roach powder in there and shutting the door and thinking that'll take care of it. And I don't mean to compare human beings like that in an invidious way, but I'm saying it takes a complete system.
They are roaches.
Certainly people that we disagree with.
But it's not just disagreeing with them. They have a nihilism to them that is...
They do. They do. But Jonathan,
world historical,
you didn't ask me about
nihilism.
Ukraine. And if you look at what's happening in Ukraine and you look at the way these Chechen mercenaries that are working with the separatists have slit the throats of these wounded Ukrainians, the way prisoners have been abused, the way civilians have been killed and brutalized in Ukraine, you'll see it's not just Islamic zealotry or radical Sunni zealotry of ISIS that's a danger in the world. There are lots of other dangers out there. And what the United States has to do is be economically strong. We've got to take care of the income distribution and wealth creation process. We've got to tend to education, infrastructure, industrial development, and be a strong enough power that we can maintain our leadership in the world and react to crises that come along like ISIS without becoming so deeply engaged in it that it rips the country apart.
We are out of time. I think with your help, we covered actually all the five threat areas and your strategy. Thank you.
Jonathan, terrific. Thank you very much.
Thank you both. And if you want to read more about what General Clark was talking about, his book is for sale upstairs. Thank you both for coming. Thank you.